Today we're going to go through, in a lightning fast fashion, classical. So we're just going to look at some of the rudiments of classical field theory. So what's our simplest concept of the field? A field is some machine which takes in a four vector and outputs a field. And the field is a function of the components of the four vector. Now this could be a scalar field. A scalar field, of course, is Lorentz invariant. But there could be other kinds of fields as well. It could be a vector field, which has three components. It could also be a tensor field, which has more components. And it could also be something more complicated, like a spinner field. And we're going to look at fields of all of these kinds in this course. This scalar, if you talk about scalar, this could be a real scalar field, it could be a complex scalar field. But let's look at certain examples. Now what we would like to do today is we would like to cast classical field theory in a way so that it becomes easier to understand quantum field theory. And of course, the guiding principle in classical field theory is Hamilton's action principle. Which simply states that a field or a particle is adjusted in such a way that the action is minimized. Right?
Yes.
Where the action is defined as L dt, the integral of the Lagrangian between two points. Okay. So now let's start our discussion by looking at a single particle. So let's write the field equation for a single particle. Now how do we do that? Suppose we just have a single particle moving along a single dimension in space. Let's call that dimension x. Now this x, of course, is a function of time. Now forget about four vectors for the time being. Let's consider what we learned in classical mechanics. We have a time variable and a trajectory of a particle. So if I draw a graph between time and the trajectory of the particle, and I focus my attention on two endpoints, Ta and Tb, I would like to find out what trajectory does the particle. This means I would like to find out what is xt. Now there are different possibilities for xt. It could be a straight line, it could be a wavy line. There's an infinite variety of possibilities that the particle can take. Now which of these trajectories is what is physically realized? That is given by the action principle. Right? So what we do is we keep the endpoints of this trajectory fixed, these are the boundary conditions. And then we vary x in such a way that this s is minimized or maximized. So we find a stationary point in s. We find its stationary value. Alright? And that will set the trajectory of the particle. Okay. Now, x is a space variable. Forget about four vectors for the time being. Just consider a single particle moving along a single dimension in space. Time here is a parameter. This is how we how we talk about time in classical fields. Now, if I replace this x with 5, nothing happens. Okay, this is just a notation of transformation, nothing unusual about it. Now, this phi is now representing x. And by the way, this is a scalar. This x is a scalar. So I'm talking about scalar fields. Okay? Now, we would like to find out the action. For that, we need to find out the Lagrangian. So, this phi t, if I were to talk about classical field theory in its full glory, I know that phi is a function of the four vector, which means that phi is a function of time and xi, correct? Now, if I am going to use this prescription for a single particle, this means that I am ignoring space variables. So, by looking at the dynamics of a particle, I'm actually looking at classical field theory in zero space dimensions. Okay? So, I'm looking at classical field theory in zero space dimensions, and I write this as 0 plus 1 dimensions. So, by looking at the dynamics of a particle, which is actually going around a single dimension, as a function of time, I'm actually doing classical field theory in 0 plus 1 dimensions. I don't have any x variable here. Okay? So this is classical field theory in 0 plus 1 dimensions. This is the time dimension, and I'm not including any space dimensions whatsoever. Okay. Now we all know that the Hamilton's principle gives us the Euler-Lagrange equations. Now if I write the Euler-Lagrange equations for a particle in this formalism, then what do I have? I have d by dt of the partial derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to partial phi over partial t minus partial phi l over partial phi. This equals 0. In general, the Lagrangian is a function of phi and phi dot. Correct? It's a function of x and x dot.
Yes.
X is phi.
Yes.
So this is the Euler-Lagrange equation, which helps us find the equation of motion, and it helps us find phi. It helps us find x. Now first look, let's look at a non-relativistic particle. Which is free. It's in a potential free region. The Lagrangian for such a particle, of course, is L equals half m phi dot squared. Correct? So this is x dot square, which I'm writing as phi dot square. So if I find out partial L by partial phi, this is, what's partial L by partial phi?
Zero.
What's partial L by partial phi dot? M phi dot. Okay. Now if I take the derivative with respect to time, I get M phi double dot is 0. Okay? There is no force acting on the particle, it's free. If I had some potential, L would be given as half m phi dot squared minus some potential d phi. So then the equation of motion could be found out. It's m phi double dot
Now, the derivative of this with respect to phi dot is 0. But the derivative with respect to phi is the derivative of this. So I will get minus partial v phi. This is just the force, a generalization of the force. Okay, so this is the equation of the motion for a single particle. So if I knew the Lagrangian, I could find use Euler-Lagrange equations, and then I could find the equation of motion for the particle. I could find the trajectory of the particle, if, and then I could also find out the action as well. And for a relativistic particle, I can use the proper, if I use the proper Lagrangian for the particle, I can find the equation of motion. For example, in on the other lecture, we found out the Lagrangian for a relativistic particle, and that was given by m into 1 minus x dot squared under. Okay? Or in ordinary units, minus m c squared over gamma. Now what we would like to do is the following. We would like to step up and talk about field theory. So with this background of the field theory applied to a single particle, which means field theory in 0 plus 1 dimensions, I would now like to look at field theory in 3 plus 1 dimensions. So, basic principles of field theory. Now the action for a particle S is given by L dt. But in the Minkowski space, d is not the only variable. We have three other coordinates as well. So it's a four vector. So what we need to do is, we need to, instead of dt, we would like to write dt, dx, dy, dz. And instead of L, generally we write the energy density per unit of these coordinates, which is called the Lagrangian density. And we have some initial value for these coordinates, some x initial and some x final. So this is all notation. The Lagrangian density is also called Lagrangian as an abuse. So whenever we say Lagrangian, actually means Lagrangian density. And this is also written as L before x. Okay, which takes into account all the four coordinates in the four vector. So now what we would need to, so time is included in this. Okay. And we also assume that the Lagrangian, okay, the Lagrangian is a function of phi, and it's a function of the first derivative with respect to phi. So this is just a generalization of this thing over. So it's a function of phi and the first covariant derivative of field. It's a function of the field and the derivative of the field. This is a scalar field or a vector field or a complex field. Okay. So this is our Lagrangian. And now we would like to write down the Euler-Lagrange equation And this is our guiding principle over here. So here we observe that he has a derivative with respect to time here. But time is not the only variable under consideration. We have four coordinates. So we would like to express this thing in four vector form, and this gives us partial mu. Remember this notation, partial mu has four components, and the four components are partial d, partial x, partial y, partial z. Alright? And this is alright. So just keep this thing in mind. Now if I were to write down the Euler and Lagrange equation for our field, just use this as the guiding principle. Instead of just taking the time derivative, we take this covariance derivative. Partial L, partial. Now, what do we differentiate the Lagrangian with respect to? Instead of just having time over here, we have partial mu phi. Minus partial L partial phi equals 0. And of course, we are always assuming the Einstein summation to be active. So this is the Euler-Lagrange equation for a classical field. Now, let's look at different applications of this equation. Now, if you were to find out the action, we would like our equations of motion to be Lorentz invariant. We could go into any frame that we like. We don't want the laws of motion to change. So we would like the Lagrangian. Suppose we like the Lagrangian to be Lorentz invariant. Okay. So we have to come up with a Lorentz invariant form of the Lagrangian. And most of field theory is actually revolving around what is the Lagrangian for the system. The Lagrangian captures the entire dynamics of the system. It has to capture the physics and it has to obey all the symmetry relationships for the physical problem that we're talking about. Okay. So finding the Lagrangian and constructing a Lorentz invariant Lagrangian forms the major task of a quantum field theorist. So let's come up with a Lagrangian and let's dabble into this affair of finding a Lorentz invariant Lagrangian. Yes.
Last time we conclude that energy is a Lorentz invariant because for four vector and momentum tensor.
But equations of motion are Lorentz invariant.
Equations of motion only.
So we would like to have a form. So this should be the equation of motion in all inertial frames. Okay. So this is our goal. For that purpose, let's come up with a Lorentz invariant Lagrangian. Okay, so we want the same equation of motion to apply. We want the laws of physics to be the same in all inertial frames.
So the equation of motion frame and variable on the tangent frame and variable on the road.
अगर आपके पास ये equation of motion चाहिए, ठीक है? If you come up with a different Lagrangian, ठीक है? So I put a prime here, and 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 I put a prime here. Then it's the same equation of motion. Okay? This will be achieved if the Lagrangian is Lorentz invariant. Okay? So let's come up with a Lorentz. So I'm saying let's come up with a Lorentz invariant Lagrangian.
This won't be true if the Lagrangian itself is not Lorentz invariant. As in, jo partial derivatives hain, wo bhi toh change honge. The part phi bhi change hoga, partial derivatives bhi change honge. Usse that won't balance out the Lagrangian change.
I don't think so. All right. So now let's propose a Lorentz invariant Lagrangian. Okay? Every scalar is a Lorentz invariant. Every scalar has to be Lorentz invariant. Okay? So we know from our classical notion that L equals half m theta dot squared is a Lagrangian. Okay? Let's find out whether this is Lorentz invariant or not. Now, what is this phi dot? For a particle, it's the derivative with respect to time. Let's assume that in our Minkowski space, our Lagrangian is half. Now, let's take this m to be 1 in this particular form. Let's take this m to be 1. Okay, let's just put this equal to 1. And we would like to find phi, the equivalent of phi dot. The equivalent of phi dot is going to be partial mu phi squared. Okay? Which is just a shorthand for 1/2. This is a shorthand for a scalar product. And what is a scalar product? It's partial mu phi, partial mu phi. Correct? Because we know that if we have two vectors, A mu, B mu, this is the scalar product between two four vectors. And this is the same as G mu nu A mu B mu. This is our definition for the scalar product. So this is just a shorthand for the scalar product. Now this is Lorentz invariant. Now what does this physically mean? Now this physically, let's roll it out. Let's unfold this scalar product. Okay? And let's see what it physically means in terms of P, X, Y, and Z. We're going to do it only once in this course so that we can understand what this term represents. First of all, just by saying that this is a scalar product, we know that this has to be Lorentz invariant. It does not depend upon the frame that we're talking about. Alright. Now this really means, this Lagrangian really means 1/2. Now mu could be 0, 1, 2, 3. So this really means partial t phi. Partial t phi, right? Minus partial x phi, partial x phi, minus partial y phi, partial y phi. Correct? Now, I'm sure you know why we have these minus signs over here. Okay, just look at the definition of the metric tensor. Now, this is simply 1/2 partial phi over partial t squared minus partial phi partial x squared minus partial phi partial y squared minus partial phi partial z squared. Okay? And if I would like to write this in shorthand, this is 1/2 of partial phi partial t squared minus the three vector divergence of phi. Okay? Now these vector signs represent that this is a three vector. Now let's look at this form. This is, of course, this is Lorentz invariant, this Lagrangian. In this particular form, it's written in the Lorentz invariant form, and it has squares of the first derivatives. If I multiply this L with any other scalar function of phi, or if I add this with any other scalar function of phi, it's still going to remain Lorentz invariant. So we have to come up with some form of the Lagrangian that makes physical sense and corresponds to the physics of the system. Okay. So by the way, this is for a free particle. If we had some potential in which the particle is moving, or another external field, then we would have to include a potential energy term as well. So loosely, this kind of term is called a kinetic energy term. But it does not necessarily correspond to our classical notion of kinetic energy. Now what we would like to do, if we have a Lagrangian of this form, we can apply the Euler-Lagrange equations and find out the equation of motion, the so-called equation of motion, or the dynamics of the field itself. Remember, what do we mean by minimization when we're talking about classical fields? We know what minimization means in the context of a particle. We fix the end points of the particle in time and find out the trajectory of the particle. Now, what does this mean in terms of a field? In terms of a field, if I make a box, one axis represents time. This is time, and the other two axes represent two space coordinates, and the third spatial dimension is somewhere tucked in inside this cube, inside this diagram. So this is really a 4 cube rather than a 3 cube, but I can't draw a 4 cube. So suppose this is our arrangement, and the walls of this cube represent my endpoints. They are the boundaries of this region in space-time. And I keep those endpoints, those boundaries fixed. So the value of phi at those endpoints is fixed. So it's fixed here, it's fixed here, it's fixed here, it's fixed on all points on the boundary. Now the task of the Hamilton's action principle basically means that I have to vary the field inside this box in such a way that the action is minimized. So I have to come up with look at all possible variations of the field inside the box, keeping the field on the surface fixed at predefined values. And the recipe for optimizing the field is given by the Euler-Lagrange equation for the field that we wrote at the top. So this is what we're doing for classical fields. Okay. Now what we would like to do is, let's look at a specific example and consider a scalar field with this Lagrangian, and on top of this let's add a kinetic energy term. So our Lagrangian is, L is half partial mu phi squared minus half some m. Now this is the mass of the particle, the so-called mass of the particle, m squared phi squared. So this is the Lagrangian for a scalar field. If this is scalar, this of course is going to be Lorentz invariant. This mu is Lorentz invariant because it's a scalar product. Okay? So this is the Lagrangian for a massive scalar field. So now let's look at the Euler-Lagrange equation. Okay? देखो potential energy is अगर यहाँ मैं phi put कर दूँ तब भी ठीक होगा, तब भी वो Lagrangian बनेगा, उसकी equation of motion आप find out कर सकते हैं. So this is generally what is done for the simplest case, and then we would like to find out whether so this is a relativistic Lagrangian. Okay, and I'm going to tell what this means. This is a relativistic Lagrangian. You would like to find out whether this Lagrangian converges to the classical Lagrangian in the slow speed limit. If it does, then this is a good choice. It's a legitimate choice. And it's scalar, it's Lorentz invariant as well, so it's a good choice. Okay? So the brilliance or the ingenuity is actually crafting this Lagrangian. Okay, but there are recipes that are available. This is one recipe that the potential energy term is a quadratic function of phi. We know this for a particle. It's x squared, y squared, or r squared. Okay. Now let me rewrite the Euler Lagrange equation. Partial L equal to partial mu phi minus partial L partial phi equals 0. Now this term is easy. It's simply minus m squared phi. Now this term requires a little bit of thought, because this term actually comprises, has four components over here. Okay? Now first of all, I'm going to do it only once. Let's set mu equals 0. So we're looking at the time variable here. Partial L . So this is what we require for the time. So if you look here, this term is simply partial phi by partial t. Okay? And if I then take the covariant derivative once again with respect to time, so I take this is partial square phi, partial t squared, right? For mu equals 1, partial L, partial x phi, this is minus partial phi, partial x, correct? If I take the covariant derivative with respect to x of this thing, I am left with partial square phi partial x square. Now see how these first derivatives, when you take the derivative again, they converge into second order derivatives. Okay, as is expected in an equation of motion. So now if I compose everything together, I'm left with partial square phi partial t squared minus partial square phi partial x squared minus partial square phi partial y squared minus partial square phi partial z squared, right? Now I need minus, there's already a minus sign here, so I get minus partial L by partial phi is plus m squared phi equals 0. Now I can also write this in the following form. Partial mu phi plus m squared phi equals 0. Okay, I can also write this as partial mu squared plus, which is just a scalar product, this scalar product here. Remember that the origin of the scalar product is not important. Plus n squared acting on phi equals 0. And if phi is non-trivial, then this thing is 0. Okay? This is called Klein-Gordon equation. This predated the Schrodinger equation, and this was the first attempt to add special relativity to quantum mechanics. Alright? And of course, you can add, this is a relativistic equation. There is nothing that is precluding relativity from our discussion. Relativity is ingrained into this discussion. And also remember that this object over here, once again, this is partial t squared minus del squared, that is the divergence. Okay? This object, sometimes this object is also called the de Alembertian. So it's an operator, by the way. It makes sense if it acts on a field. Now we would like to find out the field that satisfies this equation. Okay. So what do you think the field would be? Something that satisfies this equation. What kind of phi as a function of x mu will satisfy this equation? Remember that our Lagrangian that we're talking about at the moment does not, it's only a function of phi and partial phi. It does not explicitly depend upon the coordinates and it does not explicitly depend upon time. This means that over the regime of application of the Lagrangian, energy is conserved. So it does not explicitly depend upon time. This is a time invariant system. Okay? And this is a homogeneous equation over here. Now what could be a solution? What could be the phi that satisfies this equation? So this equation will have plane wave solutions. For example, so we're going to talk about the solution to the Klein coordinate equation. So if I take phi x mu to be e minus I some et, say et minus p dot with x. Okay. With some coefficient, of course, corresponding to the momentum that we're talking about. Let's propose a trial solution. Alright. Now, remember that this is simply a p e raised to minus I some coefficient alpha. Okay, this is all this form. So let's look at this solution. Let's look at this plane wave and see if this is a solution. All right. So we just find out this thing, we find out this thing, the derivative with respect to time twice. So if you take the derivative with respect to time twice of phi, what do we get? We get AP minus I squared minus I squared minus E. This is just a scalar m squared, so I'm left with minus e
minus b modulus squared minus m plus m squared. So this goes to the other side and I'm left with this. E is b squared plus m squared. Now we derived this relationship earlier using our definitions of contravariant and covariant, using the Lorentz invariance concept of a four vector. We constructed a four vector, the proper time interval, and from that we were able to derive this relationship. Now this is called a dispersion relationship. So it's a relationship between the energy and the momentum. Now this is the three momentum modulus squared. Now everything that we discussed so far is a classical field. Now that classical field gives rise to particles which obey this dispersion relationship. The particles emerge out of the field. So there are two concepts in quantum mechanics. One is called the first quantization. In the first quantization, particles are treated as waves. Here we have a wave. This is a wave. This is a plane wave. But out of this plane wave concept, particles will emerge. This is called second quantization. And next week, we're going to start looking at second quantization in more detail. So this is the dispersion relationship for the particles corresponding to a field that obeys the Clean-Gordon equation. And if you were to plot this dispersion relationship is intricately linked up to the Green-Gordon equation, to the equation of motion, which comes out from the Euler-Lagrange equation, for which we need a Lorentz invariant form of the Lagrange. And if you were to plot, remember that this E is plus minus B modulus squared plus M squared. And Dirac made sense of this negative sign, as you all know. So if you were to plot the dispersion relationship, what would the plot look like? This is my P. This is my E. What would the plot look like? Okay, if this were p squared, let's make a plot between E and P. This plot is going to look like this. Okay, when P is zero, this energy is M. This is called, this kind of a dispersion relationship is said to be gap. This is a gap dispersion relationship. If E were to be zero, M were to be zero, that is, we had a massless scalar field. If we had a massless scalar field, then this term is going to be zero, E equals P. So we'll have this kind of thing. Now, depending upon the relative magnitudes of P and M, this is going to change, but it takes this general form, this dispersion relationship. So, if M equals 0, which means if you have massless particles, like massless Dirac fermions in graphene, you will have a zero gap dispersion relationship, an ungap dispersion relationship. Okay? By the way, if this is a solution, this is also going to be a solution. This is also a possible scalar field that is described by the Clean-Gordon equation.
जी
सर एक्सपोनेंट की पावर में हमने टाइम के साथ एनर्जी को मल्टीप्लाई किया मतलब ई को मल्टीप्लाई किया हमें कैसे और हमें कैसे पता है कि ये जो ई है ये वही एनर्जी है ना हमने फोर वेक्टर
देखो जो आपके पास ये दरअसल व्हाट इज दिस थिंग दिस थिंग इज पी म्यू एक्स म्यू राइट सो दिस इज व्हाट वी हैव दिस इज अ फेज So if you have x here, it has to be multiplied by its conjugate variable. Okay? And p naught is e. Okay. Alright, now let's look at something more complicated. Now we all know electromagnetism. Next lecture will focus on a Lorentz covariant form of electromagnetic field equations. That is, we'll derive Lorentz covariant forms of Maxwell's equations. So what I would like to talk about now is, suppose we have a particle whose Lagrangian we wrote over here, right? This is the Lagrangian for a relativistic particle. Suppose this particle is inside a field. So now we would like to look at interactions. This Green-Gordon equation is talking about non-interacting particles. The particles that are described by this dispersion relationship are non-interacting. There's no interaction between the particles. Okay? So it's a non-interacting gas of particles. Now, we can have an electron inside an electromagnetic field. Now we have a scenario in which we have a field and we have a particle. Now, the particle can, of course, interact with the field. And the strength of interaction is determined by some parameter of the particle, like the charge of the particle, the amount of charge in the particle. Okay? Or the strength of the field. You have two classical fields, they can also interact with one another. Okay? Because the field also, in the second quantization paradigm, the field is also a particle. The field is particles. So the particles can interact, which means that two fields can interact. A particle can interact with other particles. So we have to ingrain interactions into this field theory as well. Now, what we've seen so far is a non-interacting field theory and a classical field theory. Okay? Now, before we do that, suppose we have two classical fields in our system. So we're talking about two classical fields. One could be due to phonons, one could be due to magnons, or whatever. We have two classical fields, phi 1 and phi 2. We can write a Lagrangian for these classical fields, and these fields can also interact with one another. Okay? So now we would like to put in interactions into our picture. Particles inside fields. The simplest example that I can think of. We haven't quantized anything so far, so this is classical field theory. So we know that the Lagrangian for a particle L is minus n 1 minus x dot squared. Okay. Now we have a field as well, phi x. Suppose we're talking only in one dimension. So this is, on its own, this is a 0 plus 1 field. Now we would like to add a field as well. So we'd like to add one spatial dimension. So now we're talking about a 1 plus 1 field. One spatial dimension, one time dimension. Now, if you would like, we know that this is Lorentz invariant. How do we know that? Because if we write the action as L B
So we figured out that this object minus m d tau is Lorentz invariant, because d tau is Lorentz invariant. That's the only Lorentz invariant that you can, one of the few Lorentz invariants that you can think of, the simplest one. And then from this, we found out that this could be written as minus m l d t. From where do we pick up this Lagrangian? Now what we would like to do is we would like to preserve the Lorentz invariance and somehow incorporate the effect of this field. What's the simplest recipe that we could come up with? This is a scalar. We could multiply this Lagrangian with the scalar field. It would remain Lorentz invariant. Or another thing that we could do is we could add this scalar field to M. M is a scalar, so we could write minus M plus phi X. 1 minus X squared. So this is also Lorentz invariant. So this is our first example. It's an example of how we can introduce a field, a particle inside a field, and how we could be introduce the interaction between particle and field. Now this looks really simple, but it's very profound. What we could now do is we could apply the Euler-Lagrange equation and find out the equation of motion for such a system. Okay, so let's try to do that, and let's just write down the equation of motion. Okay, let's first find out the slow speed limit of this. And another thing that we would like to do is we would like to introduce another parameter g, which is just capturing the strength of the interaction. Okay, now this g will have some dimensions. By the way, could you write this equation in its normal units, in the ordinary units? What will this equation be in ordinary units? So my goal is now, first of all, if this is a reasonable, is this a reasonable, legitimate choice for a Lagrangian, I would like to find out what does this Lagrangian represent in the slow speed limit, if c squared is infinity. Okay, I would like to look at that form. For that, I would need to adjust this Lagrangian in its natural unit. Now, how do I convert this into its natural units?
H dot of
c is minus
mc squared.
Some g phi. Let's keep this as it is. So this is a field. Let's assume that g has a proper dimension, so that this has dimensions of energy. 1 minus x dot over c. So let's look at the low energy limit of this Lagrangian. Can you find it out? Just ignore this term because v square over c square is small. Let's to first order ignore this term. This is the kinetic energy of the particle at slow speeds. Fine. This is minus the intrinsic mass energy of the system. It's inconsequential because when you take the derivatives, this turns out to be zero, it just tags along in the Lagrangian, so you can drop it out as well, keep it if you like. And this is now representing an interaction term. Okay. Now this is the field and this is the strength of the coupling between the field and the particle. Now this Lagrangian is therefore a legitimate choice. It looks like a good choice for this man. Okay? Yes.
In the earlier Lagrangian equations, we wrote down for the Lagrangian variable classical field, we use phi as a dynamical variable and its derivative. So over here, what will we be using as the dynamical variables? The position of the particle or the field itself? In the position coordinates of the field.
Okay, so okay, that's a good question, but what we're looking at right now is a particle that is inside a field. So what we would like to find out is the dynamics of the particle. We're focusing on the particle. So we take the derivative with respect to the coordinates of the particle. Okay, so we're looking at the dynamics, relativistic dynamics of a particle inside a field. Okay, that's what we're trying to do right now.
So the field is like just a potential term by this.
हम ऐसे कह रहे हैं कि the field phi, this thing here, is not uniform but it's constant in time, and the particle is inside the field. So this is our physical assumption so far, that we have a region in space. There is some background field. It could be changing from position to position. For example, electric field between two plates of a parallel plate capacitor, an electron comes inside the field. Okay, but it's constant in time. Could be non-uniform or non-homogeneous in space. And we're looking at the dynamics of the particle right now. Okay, that's what we're focusing on. So now what we would like to do is we would just like to apply the Euler's Lagrange equation. Can you please apply the Euler's Lagrange equation and find out what the equation of motion is going to be? Alright, you can do that. That's not a problem. It's not a problem. Now what we would like to generalize this a little bit further, picking up on this question. Suppose I know that my interaction is now being represented by a term of this kind. Okay? So I have a field and I have some coupling parameter, which denotes the strength of the coupling. By the way, this G is also called a source current. And it's a probe for the field. It's actually used to measure the field. For example, if you want to find the conductivity of a material, you put in a current and find the voltage drop. So that current is actually a probe which tells you what the conductivity of the material is. So this is like a probe. This factor acts as a probe to the field. But this is just a nuanced detail. So this G is also called the source current. Now let's take an interaction term of this kind and put it into the Lagrangian that we have for the field over here, for the massive scalar field. Okay, let's look at this Lagrangian and add to this an interaction term and see how the Klein-Gordon equation is modified. Now we have a particle interacting with the field. Now the question is whether this is the Lagrangian of the particle or the field. It's the Lagrangian for the entire system. The particle is being affected by the field and the field is affecting the particle. It's
impossible to think of the two as separate entities. It's a new system, and we write the Lagrangian for the system and we find the action for the system. So a choice for the Lagrangian is half partial mu phi squared minus half m squared phi squared. This is the Lagrangian that we've already had. Plus, we would like to add an interaction term to it. Alright? So, plus g phi x. Now, this is a 4 vector x. Now, you can apply the Euler Lagrange equation in full glory and find out the equation of motion. Okay? So, you get an additional term because of this. Okay, that's the only change that's going to happen. Okay, and if you so what's going to happen is that on the Klein Gordon equation, this term is going to be non-zero. This is going to have a derivative of phi with respect to x, with the coupling parameter. So this is going to modify. Nevertheless, this is a Lorentz, of course it's Lorentz invariant as well, because this is just a scalar, and it's a legitimate form for representing the interaction of a particle with the field. A concrete example, one of the very most popular examples, is that this phi x, this term is given by g over 4 factorial phi 4. Suppose, okay, this theory is called the phi 4 theory. Alright, and it's a starting point for the study of quantum electrodynamics. Okay, so if you take this value for phi, that is, you take the fourth power of phi, then you can solve the Euler Lagrange equation and you will get the following. Taking the derivative of this term with respect to phi. Because now partial L by partial phi is non-zero. Okay? So this is the field equation for the phi 4 thing.
Sorry, scalar should be gone as invariant nahi hota na. So field ko hona padega. Field ko break cost constraint hai.
Dekho, ye scalar hai. Scalar to Lorentz invariant hoga.
All scalars to Lorentz invariant hoga. So speed of light, Lorentz invariant hai. Koi aur speed, Lorentz invariant.
So speed is not a scalar.
Speed? Speed, one is all speed. Remember C.
हाँ अगर आप नंबर डालते हो तो लॉरेंस इन्वेरिएंट दैट्स जस्ट अ कांस्टेंट इट कुड हैव एनी नंबर वैल्यू व्हाटसोएवर सो वी टॉकिंग अबाउट अ स्केलर फील्ड अ फील्ड दैट डज नॉट हैव अ डायरेक्शन सो वन सो दिस इज अ पॉपुलर थ्योरी कॉल्ड फाइव फोर थ्योरी सपोज आई हैव टू स्केलर फील्ड्स राइट इट्स पॉसिबल टू हैव टू स्केलर फील्ड्स सो द लैग्रांजियन फॉर सच अ स्केलर फील्ड इज वुड बी 1 1/2 partial mu phi 1 is my first scalar field squared plus the second scalar field phi 2 squared minus 1/2 m squared phi 1 squared minus 1/2 m squared phi u squared, right? Suppose that the masses associated with both the scalar fields is the same. Let's suppose that. So these are two non-interacting scalar fields. I can have interacting scalar fields as well. So I need to come up with a Lorentz invariant form for that. One example is that I add this term, phi 1 squared plus phi 2 squared. This Lagrangian would represent is an example of two scalar fields which are in interacting, and this is the interaction term. And G represents the strength of the interaction. Alright? Now, a nice thing about this Lorentz, Lagrangian, is that it also has certain symmetry properties. So now I'm dealing with two scalar fields, two interacting scalar fields, and the example that I'm giving is this one. Now, a nice property of this scalar field, of this Lagrangian, is that it also has some additional symmetry properties. And the property of this Lagrangian is, so suppose you have a physical system which obeys certain symmetry, then the Lagrangian must reflect that symmetry. Agreed? If a process is invariant under rotations in 3D space, which is the SO3 group, then the Lagrangian must be invariant under SO3. It must respect SO3. Now suppose we have a physical scenario which is invariant under SO2 rotations. Has anyone studied group theory?
Yes.
Just one? Now, SO2 rotations are very simple to understand. SO2 rotation means that x, I have an object in the Euclidean space. Suppose I rotate the axis. Okay, now some event is occurring here, say E at x by. If I rotate the axis by some angle, theta, we are in a 2D plane. This is x prime, new axis y prime. And now if I look at this object, the coordinates are going to change in the new axis. If p prime x prime y prime equals p x y, then this object respects SO2 symmetry. So SO2 is basically an orthogonal rotation. An orthogonal rotation means if I draw a vector here, and if I draw the same vector here, the length of this vector is going to be the same in this coordinate frame and it's going to be as it is in this coordinate. The length of the vector is not going to change. So this is a special orthogonal group. So this is an orthogonal matrix of determinant 1 if you represent this matrix. So I'm not going to teach group theory, but this is the basic gist of it. So if I have a physical scenario in which I'm rotating in a 2D plane, under this rotation, then the Lagrangian also has to remain invariant. Now, how do I do a rotation? The rotation is done by a transformation which is represented by a 2x2 matrix. Let me give you an example. Suppose I have fields phi1 and phi2. Okay. Just diagrammatically, I have phi1 here, phi2 here. like to do is, I would like to find out new fields, phi 1 prime and phi 2 prime, that are related to these fields. And how are they related? I put cosine theta here, minus sine theta here, cosine theta here. Which means that I am going to rotate these axes by 2 theta. So this becomes my phi 1 prime axis. This becomes my phi 2 prime axis. Okay. And some object here, some event here, can it, of course it will be written in terms of phi 1 and phi 2, but it can also be written in terms of phi 1 prime and phi 2 prime. Okay. Now, this is the transformation that converts from one coordinate frame to the other coordinate frame. And you can always check this out by simple trigonometry. Okay? Take this to be the x-axis, y-axis, x-prime axis, y-prime axis. Find out the projections onto these axes. Okay? And you can relate x-prime to x, y-prime to y. And this is the transformation that affects this. So this is the representation of the SO2 group. Through the rotation theta, the determinant of this matrix is 1, therefore there's the S here which represents the special, it stands for special, and it's orthogonal, it's an orthogonal matrix. The transpose of this is cosine theta minus sine theta cosine theta, that's the inverse of this matrix. So it's an orthogonal matrix. Okay? So this is a representation of the SO2. Now if you were to have this kind of transformation, we would find out that L will remain invariant. So what you need to do is, we would like to find out L partial mu phi 1 prime squared plus half partial mu phi 2 prime squared minus half m squared phi 1 prime squared minus half m squared phi 2 prime squared plus g phi 1 prime squared plus phi 2 prime squared. Now if you use these relationships between the primed and the unprimed fields and you insert this in here, the Lagrangian is not going to change. This is going to be the same as the Lagrangian that we've written over here. Okay? So this Lagrangian also respects a certain kind of symmetry, which is called the SO2 symmetry. Yes?
Sir,
if you
have a square integral, it's a boost transformation.
You can say under spatial rotation. You can say under spatial rotation. वो लॉरेंस इनवेरियंस तो इसके अंदर मौजूद है, इट्स अ स्केलर, वो भी उस सारे बूस्ट भी इसके अंदर मौजूद है पहले से, उसके ऊपर वी आर पुटिंग अप द कांस्टेंट दैट दिस लैग्रांजियन हैज टू ओबे एसओ2 सिमेट्री.
सर लॉरेंस सिमेट्री के अंदर ही एसओ2
होता, लॉरेंस सिमेट्री के अंदर एसओ2 होता है. ठीक है, अब मैं ये प्रूव कर रहा हूं कि ये जो लैग्रांजियन है इसके मैं ही प्रूव करना चाह रहा हूँ कि इस लैग्रांजियन के अंदर SO2 सिमेट्री मौजूद है या नहीं. वो है, इसके अंदर मौजूद है.
और सर ये phi 1 और phi 2 को दो परपेंडिकुलर एक्सिस के लिए रिप्रेजेंट करते हैं,
सिर्फ समझाने के लिए SO2 को.
सर लेकिन मतलब स्पेस के कोऑर्डिनेट्स रोटेट करते हैं, phi 1 और phi 2 तो रोटेट करते हैं,
सिर्फ समझाने के लिए. ये बिल्कुल ये चले, इसको x ले लें, इसको y ले लें, x प्राइम ले लें, y प्राइम ले लें, सिर्फ मैंने समझाने के लिए किया. द फील्ड इज इन स्पेस टाइम, द फील्ड इज परमिएटिंग दिस एरिया, फाइन. आई एग्री.
सर इस केस में ये कैसे होल्ड करेगा, ये ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन ऑफ.
सो व्हाट आई एम सेइंग इज दैट दिस फील्ड ओबे द फील्ड्स phi 1 phi 2, they obey SO2 symmetry. Okay, so this is what I am claiming here. So this is true. This holds true. This is the transformation law between the primed and the unprimed fields. If this holds true, then I'm showing that the Lagrangian remains invariant under SO2, under the SO2 transformation.
Prime versus
x
prime, y prime,
still
needs to be different. Never na field same. Abhi kya? Is it abhi 5 prime? Because that is just give 5 1 x prime, y prime, z prime.
नहीं, मैं ये कह रहा हूँ कि जो फाइव प्राइम हैं वो अनप्राइम के साथ इस ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन से रिलेटेड हैं।
फाइव प्राइम
फील है इन अनदर कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम।
सर, फील ऑफ कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम का सेम ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन, ये जो रिलेशन आपने लिखा है
बिल्कुल सेम। फर्क सिर्फ एक्टिव और पैसिव रोटेशन के दरमियान है कि वेदर यू रोटेटिंग द कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम or you're rotating the field. It's possible to rotate the field, but that's an active rotation. It's possible to rotate just the frame, which is a passive rotation.
So, dono dependent.
Dono dependent. Now, another thing that can also be done is we could write this Lagrangian in even a simpler form. If we were to define a complex scalar field, say psi, which is a superposition of phi 1 and phi 2. Suppose we have this, we make this transformation. So instead of having two scalar fields, we write a superposition of two scalar fields, phi 1 plus iota phi 2. The complex conjugate of this field is 1 over under root 2 phi 1 minus iota. So we have two separate fields, phi 1 and phi 2. They are interacting. And this represents the Lagrangian. Now we're claiming that, first I claim that this Lagrangian respects SO2 symmetry, which means that if I were to rotate the fields under an SO2 transformation, it's possible to rotate the fields. No doubt about it. Right, you can rotate any object whatsoever. So if I have, say, let me give you an example. Now this is x and this is y. And this is a coordinate system. And I'm talking about the Euclidean space. Now I have a field here. I have a vector field here. We can have vector fields. Now there is one possibility that I rotate this vector field. I do an SO2 transformation on this vector. If I were to do an SO2 transformation through an angle theta, this vector field is going to change. This is going to be the new vector field. Alright? The vector field has changed altogether. So it's now primed vector field. Alright? So this Lagrangian has the property that if I change the fields, this is an active rotation. It's an active transformation on the fields, and the fields are being transformed under an SO2 transformation. And these primed are the new fields. Okay? So this is what I'm doing. I'm claiming here that this Lagrangian is invariant under SO2 transformation of the field. So this is an example. This vector field is undergoing an SO2 transformation. I'm not saying it's symmetric, but this is an SO2 transformation acting on a vector field. Okay. So this Lagrangian obeys SO2 symmetry. It respects SO2 symmetry. Am I clear now? Now what I would like to claim is that this Lagrangian also obeys an additional symmetry. And what is that symmetry? For that I'm claiming that let's write this phi 1 plus iota phi 2 and let's call it a complex scalar field. So this is the conjugate. Now what I would like to do, I take this Lagrangian, express phi 1 and phi 2 in terms of psi and psi vector. In terms of the complex scalar field, I can always do that. I can write phi 1 equals 1 over under root 2 psi plus psi vector, right? And I can write phi 2 as minus iota over under root 2 psi minus psi vector. Okay. Now just insert these scalar fields into this expression. And you can find out that I can write the Lagrangian in the following form. Just have to do a substitution. So you have the Lagrangian. It turns out to be we have just rescaled the G's and the M's. So there could be factors of 1/2 or 1/4, but that those are unimportant. So this is the Lagrangian. This is the same Lagrangian as this Lagrangian. Is there any additional symmetry that this Lagrangian obeys? Any other kind of transformation that you could do on the complex scalar field that this Lagrangian remains invariant? So it's Lorentz invariant, it's invariant under SO2 transformations. Is there anything else that could be done? Is there any other group under which this Lagrangian is invariant? Can I change the complex scalar field somehow that keeps this Lagrangian invariant? Constant to chalo uski to khair hai constant to
sir first term mein dono bhi upar dagger
nahi ek ek number ek
conjugate se
ek ke upar sorry
conjugate
so this Lagrangian is invariant under U1 operations so if I change psi by ei alpha psi the Lagrangian remains invariant.
You want to know the phase?
Alpha is real number. The I, a phase, phase alpha. So, if I change the Lagrangian, doesn't change. So, this particular Lagrangian is Lorentz invariant, and it obeys certain symmetry of transformations. One of them is SO2. One of them is U1. Alright, so I'm going to upload a homework today. So if I have three kinds of particles, for example, I can, so this represents two kinds of fields. This represents phi1 and phi2, two kinds of fields, which are interacting. And this represents the interaction between these particles. Suppose I add in a third field to this. So I can also write down the proposed Lagrangian for that particular scenario. So I add in the third field. Let's call it phi. Now let's call it phi 1/2. Now I have a mass term for the third kind of field for all the particle. 1/2, let's call it mu phi dot squared, and then I can add another term. So I can construct Lagrangians intelligently, and we'll look at several examples of constructing Lagrangians. But first of all, we need to look at electromagnetism in its Lorentz covariant form, and I'll describe what is meant by Lorentz covariant. It's a misused term. So I will write down the Maxwell's equation in the Lorentz covariant form. That will give our first introduction to tensor fields. So now, so far we've looked at scalar fields. Let's look at tensor fields, which are more general than scalar fields. And then we're going to quantize fields.
using the approach of second quantization. We're going to come up with the concept of particles, what is meant by particles. We're going to start off with the discussion of harmonic oscillator. Then we're going to quantize certain fields. We're going to look at certain examples from solid state physics so that we can come up to speed with what second quantization is. And then we'll start looking at quantum fields proper. All right. Thank you.